Good morning, my name is Rachel Cortezza.
I'm Joshua Lapsis.
And I'm Steve Rivera.
And our EDD teacher, Mr. Valdez, once said that EDD is a story, and today we'll be telling our story about heavy load handling in the workforce. So at the beginning of the year, all three of us had an interest in biomedical engineering, so we came together and we did some research, and we came across this problem. So according to OSHA, manual lifting of heavy objects is the most commonly cited risk factor that causes lower back pain in the workforce. And this is due to improper lifting, due to incorrect posture, or lack of strength, or heavy loads. And one of the most common injuries are MSD injuries. MSD injuries are musculoskeletal disorders that are any injuries to the musculoskeletal system or to the movement. And even though it's one of the most common injuries in the workforce, it is one of the most preventable, but it isn't often treated.
MSD injuries cause $15 to $20 billion in direct treatment per year, and one out of every $3 in workers' compensation goes for MSD treatment. Aside from money, it affects over 2 million workers, and 61% are permanently disabled for most people with skeletal disorders.
According to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, MSD accounts for 33% of worker injuries and illnesses in New America, which can be attributed to heavy load handling. With that said, we'll now further justify our problem.
We looked at data collection from the European Agency for Safety and Health of Work, and that work led to biomechanical stress, and these are some of the specific factors that cause it.
All right, according to this academic journal, states that in medical fields, nurses often have to carry loads and patients between beds and through rooms. So that results into MSDs, muscular disorders. Oftentimes, the pain originates from the lower torso.
And according to occupational medicine, based on the academic research, and in addition to nursing, there are multiple areas of work that are also affected by MSD.
According to one of our experts, Dr. Wei Zhao, who is the Director of Agricultural Safety and Health Program, these injuries cause lost time from work and severely injure permanently these workers.
According to the National Research Council, workers often feel threatened that if they don't meet the criteria of carrying the specific load handle, they'll lose their job. As a result, they overperform or exceed their limit, resulting into lower performance due to their disabilities.
And so all of these articles and justifications come together in our attack plan to justify our problem of heavy load handling in the workforce. So it is a health and safety issue because it causes injuries. It is a technical issue because lifting isn't as efficient or done properly. It is an economic issue because it's money lost for workers when they spend time out of the workforce, and it's money lost for the companies when they have workers out. And it's also a time issue because time spent recovering is time spent away from the workforce and from time with your loved ones. And so now we move on to developing our solution.
To start our engineering process, we first looked at other solutions to bag MSDs in the workforce, typically exoskeletons. So here we have the V22 ergoskeleton, the label exoskeleton, the MAX, and the HAL. They were all very durable, but as you can see, they're very costly, up into the thousands, and the HAL is not available to the public yet.
And so for brainstorming, in order to develop a solution, we need to generate ideas. And so we have this brainstorming mind map here, where we divided the possible solutions into three categories. Environment, there are things that you can apply, like ideas you can implement, such as laws and regulations and worker education. But then the one that we're more focused on are in terms of humans and equipment, because humans, we're talking about treatment or things we can give to humans to assist them, and equipment is external factors or external equipment that they can use to help with lifting. And so when we developed this, we decided to take a mechanical approach and help humans by prevention rather than treatment afterwards. So we're making a mechanical solution for humans to wear. And so that's why we're combining those ideas together.
So here's our first design matrices. While we examine our solutions, possible solutions, we have seven, and here are our specifications. In summary, we thought that elastic braces and exoskeleton were the top choices for our idea. So elastic braces essentially is active correction. So unlike a rigid one, it can actively correct your posture as you bend, work, and move around. Whereas a rigid constricts you into a certain position, resulting in potentially harming you in a worse condition. So, however, we ended up using a passive exoskeleton as our definite solution because its ability to efficiently transfer weight from different muscle groups is more beneficial than to have an elastic brace.
So our second design matrix narrowed down attributes that we wanted to see in our solution. So we evaluated torsion strings, pneumatics, belts, back braces, compression strings, and leg braces, and we compared to similar specifications. All of the following, except leg braces and compression strings, we chose to utilize. Most were satisfactory, but cost and reliability did come into play because we felt like torsion strings would accomplish what we wanted more than compression strings could.
And so our group came to the consensus that our solution that we wanted to develop would be an exoskeleton that is suitable for our stakeholders. And so with it will be a passive back and leg support system and a pneumatic locking system that will help with reducing the stress on the lower back.
We believe at that time our solution will be adjustable to many sizes because it can easily be adjusted using straps. The torque can be easily changed by winding up the torsion springs, and it actively corrects the posture because similarly to an elastic, it can easily store energy and bring it back to you and correct your posture that way. Also, it doesn't hinder your movement. Because with a torsion spring, disengaging it will enable you to walk freely, and rotational-wise, because it's going to be a tight fit and it's going to be constricted to your body, and it won't have any bulky areas where it could potentially inhibit your movement.
We wanted our device to function to promote proper lifting techniques, support the lumbar spine and lower extremities, and limit injuries that are caused by lifting. And for ergonomics, we wanted it to fit well onto the human worker and designed to support them while lifting and be easily carried and worn.
So essentially, we wanted also to be durable, capable of withstanding several years of use and during the process. Finally, we also wanted to be $100 to $250 within the cost with these four materials.
And then, in addition to that, we have established parameters to fit our solution in terms of what we envisioned that we need our invention to have. So this includes the fact that we want it to be lightweight because the workers have to wear it throughout the day. The price, we want it to be cheaper than all their alternatives on the market. We want it to be durable and adjustable because, again, it will be used by different workers. And we wanted the torque to be great enough to reduce the stress of bending because, again, our goal is to reduce the lower back injuries. And the heart rate, we want it to reduce muscle strength.
To test our parameters, we were going to weigh our prototype of pounds, analyze the cost compared to other competing devices, test for failure points, see if it fits a variety of body types, and we're going to measure the force of the torque to see if it achieves our goal, and we were going to see if it lessens muscular strain, which is also tied to heart rate. These were concept sketches or napkin sketches. For our first design, we had adjustable straps, and it was entirely passive. And our second one, it has pneumatic pistons that were going to aid in the less passive. And we continued to combine desirable attributes from both of these.
So as Cindy said, we combined it to create this final concept sketch, as you can see here. And in order to test the viability, we conducted a survey with our target demographics. And so we provided a description of our device in addition to asking them the questions that you see up here. And as you can see by the first question, based on function, the majority of them liked it and believed it would perform to what it said. And many people also liked the aesthetics of it. However, one thing to consider was that we weren't sure that this is entirely accurate because our pool of surveys are not entirely representative of the population that we wanted to because it was random and we have no clue as to who exactly took our survey.
So we also went into consider what else about our public. population we have to look at. We wanted to see what kind of loads they typically carried, which is typically 25 to 74 pounds, and most of our workers were within the 18 to 45 age range.
So here finally is our final solution. We have two systems. One is going to store the energy and retract and bring it back to your body to correct your posture and aid you in lift, which is located in the lower torso right there, above the buttocks. And our second system is our pneumatic lock, which will hold the system in place while you go up and down and release, enabling you to walk freely. So here's a free body diagram of all the forces interacting with you. Essentially, you're going to have a net force on the right, in the x-axis, resulting in your body bringing back your body to a stand-up position. So finally, our pneumatic lock. The reason why we want to do this is that, for instance, the labo exoskeleton has a trouble when it comes to walking because the spring is constantly active, and your result, if you lift up your leg, it's going to activate the spring. You're going to deflect the spring, resulting into it pushing back on you. So you're going to feel 5 pounds of force pushing back down your leg. So by being able to control the deflection angle, we're going to be able to reduce the amount of force acting on your leg, enabling you to walk. So we can essentially have 50 pounds of torque or 50 pounds of force against your body, enabling you to lift, and we can essentially disengage the pneumatics and allow you to walk freely.
And then so after our concept has been justified, we moved on to building. And so what we have here is a Gantt chart. And so we divided it into three main parts after developing our technical sketches. And afterwards, we tested and evaluated our design, and we'll go into that right now.
So here's our past iterations. Essentially, we decided at first to go with something small and compact. The reason being is that it's going to easily contour to your body, whereas something big and bulky would have a difficulty conforming to the extremities of your bodies. So essentially, we also decided to go with three straps rather than four because less control on your chest, which would may pose a problem in the rotational movement that might cause endurance. But we, as a result of using all three straps and having something small, we sacrifice our ability to have something that's very stable and that can be easily centered. This cannot be easily centered or easily used.
And so what we did is that this is our technical sketch of our final design. So we have a brace strap system that is symmetrical so that the weight is evenly distributed. And here we have the pneumatics, and as you can see here, here's our final design. So here is the polywall, and so we kind of pinned the straps to the polywall, and then we have attached the pneumatics to it.
For the lower back piece, these are our first iterations. We first utilized PVC pipe that we heated to shape to support the legs into our preferred shape, and it was going to be then connected to a belt with torsion springs on the back. The chest piece was bulkier, made with the same plywall material, but it was designed to compress the torso into a proper bending position that was well postured.
Here's your technical sketches. And here's our execution. So the way we executed is that we cut the torsion spring into two individual 6 inches width, and then afterwards we welded carbon steel rods on each end, and at the very middle we welded them all together with the carbon steel rod in the very center. So here's our final iteration of our lower back for torsion spring.
And then as far as pneumatics go, what we did was that we coated the robot feet. It was a very simple program. So all we did was that we had a switch, and so whenever the switch would be pushed down, then the pneumatics would be activated, and whenever you let go, then it would be released. And we have a demonstration of that later.
So the materials we used were pneumatic double-acting pistons, a pneumatic tank, carbon steel rods, plywall plastic, torsion springs, and it all came to a cost of $92, which is well below competing prices that go into the thousands.
And so as far as safety goes, we followed the safety rules. So we made sure everybody wore the proper safety equipment, like safety goggles and heat gloves. And also we ensured that the tools that we used, we knew how to use them properly before using them.
So here's a platform prototype. It conforms strictly to my body. It engages between the lower and the upper systems engage properly, and
so now with our prototype, we move on to testing.
So here's the durability. Essentially, according to it was tested 10,000 times. Tensile strength, the way we did it was we wound it up as much as we can until it broke. The tensile strength is considerably low compared to its original, which would be around 60K. And that's because when you weld carbon steel rods, you weaken the molecular structure of the rods, resulting into a lower tensile strength. So, and here's our other mathematical data.
And then here are the pneumatics in action. So in the GIF, as you can see, Lapsus pushes down on the switch, and then the pneumatics activate. And when he releases them, it lets go. And so this has a max force of 7.66 pounds. And this is because we were using VEX pneumatics. However, if we were to use a different type of pneumatics, perhaps a stronger one, we could increase that max force.
Well, for low capacity and heart rate, we use an oxometer to measure heart rate and oxygen saturation to compare before and after results using our device and without it in increments of 10, 25, 35, and 45 pounds being lifted. There's very little difference in the heart rate and oxygen saturation between the two due to instrumental error with the devices that we had access to. However, there was a difference in strain. We did feel a difference in those being easier to lift with the device was worn. For weight imbalance, because of the contour of the design is really close to my body dimensions, the weight of the device does not hinder balance or the center of gravity, and the weight is hardly felt at all.
And so as far as adjustability goes, so what we had was that we had a belt buckle strap, and we also had the adjustable straps on top. So both of them were able to fit our mannequin, who is the average for our intended audience, so the workers. And in addition, we tried it on all three of us, and we are very different in sizes, yet it was able to fit all three of us. And again, it's very easy to be adjusted. And so our closing remarks. So overall, we thought that our solution did a good job in solving the problem that we wanted to attack. And with our available resources, our current prototype was a pretty good success. And we were able to fulfill the majority of our parameters. However, we do think that we would have benefited if we had additional testing, and that would come with more time and more resources.
Future modification is that we do intend to use, pursue a better solution to use a better form of steel rather than the steel rest, because due to its properties, we can instead weld piece to it. So maybe possibly using something like mild steel, which has a lower carbon content than carbon steel. And also, we do plan to use better substitutes to these carbon steels so that you can easily use, it won't be hard on the body.
In addition, we would want to do more tests or perhaps try different things that could help improve it. So maybe trying out an electrical system,
like an EMG, for instance, because our data for whether the muscle activations weren't accurate at all. We'd like to use an EMG to see if muscle activation is less or greater than with or without the system.
And then in addition, what we learned is that one, failure is an option, because we went through different iterations to develop our current solution, but obviously it wasn't going to be perfect on the first try. So we just took those opportunities to improve what we had and to try to develop it to make it better. And also we learned that engineering is a never ending process. So even though this is our current solution that stands before you today, we can always improve it in different ways. Making it cheaper, making it more effective, things like that, of that nature.
Thank you very much.
We would like to thank our experts for advising us and using their expertise to help us through the project process, and our teachers for guiding us through the EDD journey, our fellow students who helped us make our prototype, and to you, our judges and audience, for being here to support us and watch our presentation. Thank you.
Any questions? Yes?
Well, what's the biggest obstacle of your project?
So one of the biggest obstacles was putting all the pieces together. So when we worked at it with the different parts, like the pneumatics, and then the lower back and the upper back, And then when we finally put them together, we had to make sure that they were together. And one of the issues was that when we were testing durability by winding up the torsion spring, it broke on us. And so that was kind of surprising because we didn't expect that to happen. But then we learned from it, and then we re-welded it with a different, re-welded it again. And so like our iterations, just going through that process was one of the biggest problems.
Any other questions?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Oh, okay.
Well, you guys were making this, the exoskeleton, like, were there any safety concerns for making it? Was there anything that might have been dangerous to pop off? Change the whole entire thing?
It's very safe to wear. The only thing that we might improve upon in the future is maybe creating something to cover the springs and the metal so they can't catch on anything in the workforce. But as of now, as a first iteration over a year's work, it's practically very safe. No screws will pop up.
And in addition, we did have expert input who talked about how the bottom parts of the metal rods, how we should try to cushion that. And we would like to address that in our future solutions, but as of right now, this is what we have.
Any other questions?
Yes, sir. Yeah, you all three wore the prototype, right?
Yes, sir.
What do you guys think? I mean, did you feel uncomfortable? At the end of the day, if you're gonna use this for somebody else to wear, I mean, at the end of the day, what did you think? I saw you in the picture. Did it help? Was it uncomfortable? Did you think it was awkward?
So I guess this can be comparable to what you can say is those belts you wear for deadlifting.
Right.
Because we actually had the inspiration of having the back plate.
Right.
Similar to that, so that it provides us the same lumbar support as the deadlifting belt. When I was wearing it, I essentially felt, I guess the only problem I had with it was sometimes if the pneumatics goes up too high, the whole bar disengages, so that could possibly be a safety issue, which we could possibly solve.
But I think in comparison to other solutions on the market, this is a low-cost alternative that does pretty well for at its price. And obviously, it's not the most comfortable thing in the world, but it's pretty comfortable.
And I guess I just want to reiterate the most important part of our design was actually just the locking mechanism, being able to just wind up the torsion spring several times and have that force helping you going up is really helpful. And at the same time, being able to walk with that wound up, because like, easily reduce the deflection angle, and you can easily just lift up your leg compared to other solutions, which they don't necessarily have that idea or implementation into their solution.
Also, posture-wise, when I wore it, I felt like it did keep my back straight, especially when I bend down. And when the torsion springs are wound, there is a significant pull on the back that does help you lift things. And I was noticing it helping lifting chairs, small tables, things like that. So it definitely works, although we would probably improve comfortability, such as the leg parts.
So there was a significant improvement on the...
Yes, sir.
But due to the fact that we didn't have like EMGs or special medical equipment to quantify it, we can say for sure, statistically-wise, that it made a big difference. But for our perspective, the way we felt, we believe that it did make a slight difference.
How about noise? Was there a rattling or when you moved around, was there any noise that was going on that you noticed that might be comfortable for people around?
Not much noise, except when the pistons engage and disengage, it does rub up on the rod, but it's not incredibly loud compared to electronic exoskeletons.
Yes, you can just add like Teflon just to have it easily slide up and down. Any other questions? Yes?
Workers can wear these exoskeletons they lift things for about maybe hours at a time.
Yes.
Would it be comfortable enough to wear for an extended amount of time?
That's something that we've yet to test. We didn't really look into the endurance of wearing something like this. Testing aid-wise, we could probably just walk around using it with different people, like small case studies with like a group. But other than that, we didn't really engage into endurance of how long would it provide any discomfort in a long period of time.
Another thing, the workers obviously carry a lot of loads. But if they were wearing the exoskeleton, for example, they would trip and fall on their back, would that have any effect? So, would the exoskeleton have any further effect on the incident? Also, that's the thing we've yet to answer. But surely there shouldn't be anything prodding or poking at the of the person. Everything is pointed exterior wise, and the metals we used weren't necessarily strong enough to pierce through the polymer.
And I'd like to add a little bit to that. This is one of our first iterations, so we didn't consider that in great detail because we just wanted to focus more on the form and function first. But that is a great thing that we want to, if we were to.
Any other questions? But these legs, you have to pre-wind them before you put them on, and you have to need someone to hold it together while you put it on, essentially. Because right now, the deflection or the force generated by the torsion spring is not significant enough, so you have to wind it up around 2 times to feel a significant force in helping you.
So right now, it is better to have 2 people help you, but in the future, we would like it to be easier to put on with just 1 person. Any other questions?
What if someone was a little bit overweight, and they still be able to put on the device comfortably?
Overweight? We focus generally on this mannequin. So we haven't really tested anyone that's overweight. We believe that the straps currently aren't capable of fitting someone that's morbid.
Not necessarily morbidly obese, but for us, general sizes, but for someone who is a little bit heavier, the straps do extend all the way to the back, so you can loosen it twice the amount that I am. And also the belt, you can tighten it from all the way close to the buckle from all the way over here, so it can fit many mid-waistlines.
In addition, we could have like custom pieces, so if the belt, for example, wasn't long enough, we can just accommodate that by adding a longer strap.
Any other questions?